Hey guys, it's Medicosis Perfectionatus, where medicine makes perfect sense. Let's continue our biology playlist. In previous videos, we have talked about neurulation, implantation, gastriulation, etc. Today, it's time to talk about the stem cells. What is the difference among totipotent, pluripotent, multipotent, and unipotent? With that said, now let's get started. This is my biology playlist. Today is video number 29. Please watch them in order. As you know, any corporation is structured like this, what Jordan Peterson might describe as the dominance hierarchy. The employees has certain missions. They cannot do just whatever they want. However, Jamie Dimon can do anything he wants. Same story with your stem cells. Unipotent can only differentiate to one type and one type of cells only. Example, let's say cells are responsible for making just red blood cells. That's about it. That's a unipotent. Uni means one. Potent means strong or capable. How about multi? Multi means many. Oh, I can give you red blood cells. I can give you platelets. I can give you neutrophils. Thank you so much. How about pluripotent? Well, I can differentiate into red blood cells, neutrophils, platelets, monocytes, eosinophils, and even lymphocytes. How about totipotent? I'm like the CEO. I can give whatever the flip I want to give. I can give you a neuron. I can give you a muscle cell. I can give you all of your blood cells. I can give you epithelium to cover your surfaces and line your cavities. Doesn't that sound filthy? And I can also give you basement membrane, connective tissue, etc. As you go from totipotent down to unipotent, the potency decreases. And as you go up, the potency increases. Differentiation and determination are synonymous. How can I induce a unipotent stem cell to make me some red blood cells? Well, you will need some morphogens. How do I induce multipotent? You also need morphogens. Can you give me examples of those morphogens that induce the differentiation? Sure. How about EGF, TGF, VEGF? Oh, why do all of them end in GF? Because they stand for growth factor. Oh, and what will a growth factor do? Induce growth. Duh. EGF is epidermal growth factor. TGF is transforming growth factor. VEGF is vascular endothelial growth factor. And why do we call them stem cells? Because it's like the stem of a tree. It can branch out into many different cells. Hashtag differentiation. Consider your bone marrow, for example. Your bone marrow can give you red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, okay? And that's why these cells are pluripotent stem cells. Then I divide them into myeloid and lymphoid. You can consider myeloid to be pluripotent stem cell. And then the erythroblast or normoblast, that's a unipotent. It can only give you one cell and one cell only. And this is the red blood cell. I don't mean like one individual cell, I mean one type of cells. Myeloid can also give you BEN, basophils, eosinophils, neutrophils. BEN, the granulocytes. And then monocytes, megakaryocytes, and platelets. And then you have the lymphocytes. How can we tell the bone marrow to make more red blood cells? It's called EPO. And therefore, you can consider EPO to be a morphogen. Morpho means morphology, shape. And gen means genesis, generation, creation. All right, how do I make my bone marrow to make me some granulocytes like these three? Oh, use a GCSF. What does G stand for? Granulocyte colony stimulating factor. And therefore, GCSF is a freaking morphogen. How can I induce my bone marrow to make monocytes? Well, guess what? It's going to be called MCSF, monocyte colony stimulating factor. I love it. How about those lovely platelets? It's called TPO, thrombopoietin. So we have erythropoietin for the erythrocytes and thrombopoietin for the thrombocytes. You know the story, right? Fertilization and then zygote. And then you get your morula. And then after this, the blastocyst. Implantation of that blastocyst. Bilaminar embryo. Bi means two. Epiblast, hypoblast. And then the trilaminar. We have endoderm, mesoderm, ectoderm. Do you remember the bilaminar embryo? Yes, I do. Do you remember when I've told you that your inner cell mass or the embryoblast is what's going to give you the entire embryo? Yes, I remember. And therefore, the embryoblast cells are totipotent stem cells because they can literally give you anything you want. You want epithelium? You got it. You want connective tissue? Why not? You want some nervous tissue, muscle tissue? Sure. We can give you anything, and that's why we are totipotent. How about the trilaminar, endoderm, mesoderm, and ectoderm? Well, the endoderm cannot just give you anything. For example, the endoderm cannot give you the nervous system. That's the job of the ectoderm. And that's why each one of these is pluripotent. Here's a quick question. We know that embryos have stem cells, all right. How about adults, like doofuses like you and I? Do we have stem cells? Believe it or not, the answer is yes. Where do you get your epidermis from? From the stratum basalis, or the basal layer of the skin. Oh, where is it? It's in the epidermis. What does it do? It makes new epidermis. So you consider it a stem cell? Sure. It divides and produces epidermis for you. Oh, that is wonderful. How about pneumocytes type 2, which has two functions. Function number one, to make the surfactant. Function number two, oh, it's a stem cell to give you your lung cells, such as your alveoli. That's a stem cell, baby. How about your hematopoietic stem cells in your bone marrow every single day, dishing out tons of red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets? Yes, they are stem cells. Remember the spermatogonia? It's dishing out millions of sperms every day. That is a stem cell.
But how about a stem cell for my neurons?
Shut up. Neurons are permanent cells. You are an adult now, okay? You have no more cells that generate neurons. You are set for life with the kind of neurons that you have today. A permanent cell is the cell that stays in G0 and it doesn't enter the cell cycle. It is here, so we have, like, let's say you have 1 trillion neurons. Okay, you will be left with 1 trillion neurons throughout your life. Yeah, if this one lost, like if you cut the axon, yes, the axon can regenerate. But if you lost the entire cell body, it's not coming back, baby. I'm sorry. Permanent cells are neurons, heart cells, muscle cells, and the red blood cells.
But how about the hematopoietic stem cells?
Yeah, the hematopoietic stem cells and the erythroblast, yeah, they can regenerate. But the mature, young red blood cells, yeah, once you lose it after 120 days, it's over. How about stable cells? Well, most of the time they are in G0, but in a rainy day they will sacrifice and enter the cell cycle to produce and regenerate. Example, your liver does not regenerate under normal circumstances, but if you lost half of your liver, the other half will grow and you will have a complete liver before you know it. How about your kidney tubules? Well, sometimes, let's say you are a doofus, you took an entire bottle of aspirin pills, or freaking penicillin, or tetracycline, or whatever. This can lead to acute tubular necrosis. The kidney is toast. However, if your doctor put you on dialysis for like 3 days or something, you'll be so happy because the kidney tubules will regenerate and you will have a normal kidney before you know it. And that's why we call this acute kidney failure, not the chronic renal one. How about labile cells? Oh, they are dividing all the time like it's nobody's business. Sperms. Oh, spermatogonia, they divide like crazy. How about hair? Oh, of course, that's why you need to shave all the time. Bone marrow, dishing out millions of red blood cells every single stinking day. How about your gut epithelium? It is constantly regenerating and that's why it's very hard for you to develop cancer of your small intestine. Because if it happens, you will lose it in the stool in less than 24 hours. So it's just rapid regeneration and shedding of old epithelium. Some clinical pros for the pros. What is DNA replication? Well, it's like one DNA, now it's two DNAs. Happens at the S phase. What is cancer? Uncontrolled replication. A cell, a crazy cell, one crazy, stupid, ignorant mutant cell that is dividing like crazy due to errors or mutations. What is a chemotherapeutic agent? Anything that hits those rapidly dividing cells. It inhibits replication. Some antibacterials and antivirals are also interfering with the cell cycle of the bacteria and viruses respectively. Chemotherapy, what are you trying to accomplish? I'm an anti-cancer drug. I'm trying to kill those cancer cells. How? I interfere with the replication. Why? Because cancer cells are rapidly dividing cells. That's the good news. The bad news is I can affect any cell of your own body that divide quickly, because rapidly dividing cells are the most vulnerable. Example, hair. Oh yeah, hair divides like crazy. And that's why people who take chemotherapy suffer from hair loss. Diarrhea, sure, my gut is dividing like crazy. I'm losing epithelium from my gut all the time. And that's why one of the most common symptoms or side effects of chemotherapy is diarrhea. Next, teratogens. Okay, gen, to generate, genesis. Okay, generate what? Terato, which literally mean a monster. If during pregnancy, mommy is exposed to a teratogen, she can give birth to, forgive my language, a little monster. Example, alcohol. Alcohol is bad for a pregnant lady because it can affect the embryo. It's a teratogen. Let me ask you a question. Is alcohol bad for the embryo? in the first trimester, second trimester, or third trimester? Well, make no mistake about it, alcohol is bad for every trimester, especially the first trimester. Why? Because in the first trimester, you are making tons of cells. You are dividing like crazy. And we have agreed that the rapidly dividing cells are the most vulnerable. So the earlier, the worse. Alcohol is very bad for the first trimester, especially around week 4 or from week 1 to week 4, because this is when the cells are actually being made. Everything starts at week 4. When does your nervous system start to form? About week 4. Cardiovascular system, week 4. Lung, week 4. Everything is about week 4. So from week 1 until week 4 or 5, it is really a vulnerable area. Give me examples of these bad teratogens: smoking, alcohol, folate deficiency, phenytoin, warfarin, thalidomide, and others. I'll give you an example. Folate deficiency. Let's say mama is pregnant and mama does not have enough folate. Folate deficiency can increase the risk of neural tube defects. The baby is born with something in the back. Oh, what is this? Abnormal neurulation. Problems with the neural tube. Go back to my previous video on neurulation to know what the neural tube is. Folate helps close the neural tube. You close the anterior pore, the posterior pore, etc. Alright, but if mama is folate deficient, the neural tube is not gonna close. If the posterior neural pore did not close, the baby is gonna have spina bifida. If the anterior neural pore did not close, the baby is gonna have anencephaly, which literally means no brain. Cephalo, brain, and no brain. And of course, this is fatal. Or the baby's brain cannot divide into right and left hemispheres. The baby will have just one hemisphere. We call this holoprosencephaly. Cephalo, brain. Prosencephalon, that's the forebrain. Holo means whole. It did not divide into right and left hemispheres. And when your cerebrum does not divide, your eyes are not going to divide into two eyes. You will end up with cyclopia. What's the difference between exocrine and endocrine glands? Alright, an exocrine gland is a beautiful gland like this that has a duct. And the duct will take the secretions from the acinus, which is glandular epithelium, okay? And put those into a nearby structure, such as your gut. Have you noticed that the acinus is lined by cubical or columnar epithelium? Yeah, because it's gonna secrete something, correct? Therefore, it needs to have a space to store these doozy secretory granules. But imagine that your glandular epithelium was like this. Oh, what is this? Now, where the flip would I store the secretion? You don't have any space. And that's why glandular epithelium, any cells that secrete anything, is gonna be columnar or at least cuboidal. However, the duct epithelium is flat. It is squamous. Why is this? Because we want space. We want to allow some space for the secretions to flow. We don't need them to secrete anything. How about an endocrine gland? Again, glandular epithelium secreting some kind of secretions directly into the bloodstream, not in a duct. These glands are ductless. Like in today's world, coffee has become caffeineless. Beef is now meatless. And these endocrine glands are ductless. They just dump the hormone into the bloodstream. And this bloodstream will take the hormone into distant locations. So, exocrine versus endocrine. Exocrine has a duct, endocrine is ductless. Exocrine will secrete the secretion into the duct, but endocrine will secrete the secretion into the bloodstream. Exocrine will secrete something into a nearby structure, but endocrine will secrete the hormone, which will go to distant locations all over your body. Can you give me an example of an organ that has exocrine and endocrine glands in the same organ? Let me know the answer in the comment section. If you want to learn more about cancer and how do we treat cancer pharmacologically, check out my anti-cancer pharmacology course on my website, medicosisperfectionist.com. And you can get a 30% discount towards anything on my website. Just use promo code SAVE30 at checkout. It's only available for the next 3 students only. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe, hit the bell, and click on the join button. You can support me here or here. Go to my website to download my courses. Go to Picmonic for some doozy animated medical mnemonics. Thank you for watching. As always, be safe, stay happy, study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionatus, where medicine makes perfect sense.